Sup guys, Heeking here, bringing you a review on the on the Attack on Titan anime series. Haven't been doing these regularly like I should have been. Kind of waited. Like I think I did this last time as well when I did my first review. I kind of did a review on all three episodes in it. So this is a review on episodes 4, 5, and 6, I believe. We're on to episode 7 now, aren't we though? So I'm so confused where what review I left it up on. I don't even remember if I did episode 4, if it was episode 5 or not. I forget easily in it, so I'm trying to remember the first episode, first two episodes were that all action segment stuff, and then episode 3, episode 4, I don't even remember. I don't remember where we got off on. I'm just gonna get to the good points basically of the episodes that I remember anyway, but for starters I'm gonna start with the negatives. This uprising arc has been both a good and bad adaptation. As a manga reader, you know, I went back and read the manga, I realized that a lot of the scenes were rearranged, that certain events that happened on specific days were rearranged to happen in the space of just one. And on one hand, it makes sense why they did that, because they wanted the anime adaptation to go on a very fast pace to get through all the boring stuff. But in my opinion, that was sort of the wrong thing to do, because I really did, you know, I reread it and I really did enjoy a lot of those slow moments. And I'm just going to name a couple of the scenes I wish they had adapted properly in this adaptation. The first one being the whole experimentation stuff they did with Eren when he was in his Titan form, where he was building stuff, where they were making him do these tests, and then where they tried to get Eren to write, for example, so he could communicate to them, and he wrote something regarding his dad, and that sort of caused him to have like a massive relapse or headache, and that was sort of the first clue that, you know, he might have eaten him. So I would have wished they'd kept that stuff in there, but in just the first episode they just sort of skipped over that very quickly. I guess it wasn't important, because I feel like they left enough clues in the anime as a whole to make people start to realize and suspect that yeah, maybe Eren did eat his dad. The other stuff they cut out, the second stuff that I wish they'd kept in, was the newspapers characters. We got them, but the whole reason as to why they ended up helping, you know, Hanji out in the first place was cut out. Instead, you've got this mini moment with Virgil where he convinces them, and it's done very quickly. But in the manga, there was a lot more to it. There was a lot more, like, you know, you had Hanji there being all badass, sneaking in like Batman, just standing there listening to them, admitting that she was gonna break these guys' arms, but because she listened and saw that, you know, that these guys are being threatened, their families are being threatened, so they have no choice but to follow the law and the orders. But the young dude sort of giving in and fighting and, like, you know, no, we have to tell the truth and convincing them, you know, that was all cool to see. So I would have loved to have seen that adapted. And then of course, the main thing that I wish the anime adaptation had kept was Reeves' entire character and why he does what he does. That whole moment when he gets captured and then Levi takes him to the top of the wall and he convinces him to help him and to help their group out. And you kind of see this different side of Reeves, that he's not such an arsehole, that he is actually sort of a caring dude, like, and he agrees to help them, and you get this moment with him and Historia as well, where it's like, you know, once you're queen, and especially that they cut that all out, they cut the whole Historia having to become queen, and I'm starting to suspect that this might actually be next episode, because, you know, if they want to make Historia the queen, right, if they want to install her as the queen, then we need to see that moment where she has to make that choice. And, you know, that's something important that's going to come up in, not next episode, but the episode after that, because the episode after that, I'm pretty sure, is going to be episode 9, is going to be the episode where they have to fight, the Rice Titan. And that's going to be Historia's big moment. So, you know, in order for Historia to come to that conclusion that she wants to be the queen, she needs to have that talk. So I'm wondering if they've rearranged it so we can have that sequence with her and Levi, maybe, next episode. I don't know, but they need to do that. That's a sequence they definitely need to do. But yeah, as a whole, as far as the adaptation goes, it has been sort of disappointing to not get those scenes, because those were very human scenes, and the arc as a whole showcased that it wasn't just about these characters, it was about these other characters. We got to see an insight into the lives of all of these other people that live inside the walls, and we don't get that really here, and it's so disappointing how rushed the anime has gone through that. So yeah, I'm very disappointed by that. But in terms of adapting everything else, in terms of the big moments, right, it's done such a decent job, actually. I believe episode 5 was the whole thing with Erwin's trial, and they did such a good job with that. Like, that whole sequence of events, just to showcase how, you know, what a great tactician Erwin is. But not even that, it's a case of Pixar's having, played his own role in terms of getting the truth out of those government official people, right? And to see the reactions. And that was a great way to sort of see where they all stand, and for Pixar to basically make the decision that, yeah, he's gonna side with Erwin and pull a Kubotar, and then getting Zach really in there as well. Exactly, you know, he's only been in season 1, I believe. He didn't appear, I think, in season 2 at all. Maybe I'm wrong, and he probably had one scene. But yeah, he gets his moment here to shine. He comes in and yeah, he just takes over everything completely. And it was such a great moment to see that adapted, and to find out that the king was a false king. Like, a lot of people are getting confused that the officials were sort of lying or not taking orders from Rice, but they technically are. It's just that Rice is sort of protecting his identity, basically, by having a false king installed, so no one will actually suspect who the real king really is. So no one will steal the power of the Titan, which unfortunately, you know, Erwin's dad found out who it really was, and he took it. So, you know, in the end, keeping his identity secret didn't do shit, really. But yeah, it was such an Iron Man 3 moment, actually. But at the same time, it's like, it doesn't take away the enjoyment of it, where that film did, because in the end of the day, this dude didn't really do nothing. He was basically all pretty much just a figurehead for display purposes only. But yeah, that episode as a whole was great. That's a great example of just a dialogue, just pure dialogue, 100% dialogue scene done right, if that makes sense. Like, no action, but just the way it was handled, and the way that Erwin and the other characters played the other characters sort of in this little mind game was great. So yeah, sometimes you don't need to have a fancy action scene. Sometimes an action scene can just be characters messing with the other characters' heads. So yeah, that was great to see, like, the way they just threw a curveball and then turned it on the side. And then episode 6 was the big episode where pretty much we all found out why, where Erwin's dad is, and we basically found out straight away from the beginning of the episode that Erwin's dad was eaten, and that Erwin himself ate him, because we find out during that episode that Erwin's dad stole the power of the Titans, the power that can control the Titans with the scream, from the Rice family. And if you pay attention to that, again, this moment with Frieda and the flashback, I mean, all that stuff was supposed to come earlier and sort of be set up, but they all did it in just the space of that one episode. So again, it feels just sort of like rambling rush, because it sort of comes out of nowhere, if that makes sense. And the little hints we got in the manga were all set up, like, it was supposed to give you hints and then lead up to that moment here. It's just like, we're gonna throw that in here, and then boom, there you go. It was just an overload of information, and that, you know, on one hand, it's good for the anime viewers because they've been waiting years for this stuff, but as far as adaptation goes, you cannot understand why the manga went the way it did to sort of build us up for that hype when it got to it. But here, there's no real hype, it's just it threw you in there immediately. That said, the last episode before that, I believe there was a moment of Armin where he basically concluded that, he put two and two together after the conversation that Erwin heard between Bertold and Ymir, that obviously, yeah, he had to have eaten, Armin comes to the conclusion that he had to have eaten someone with Titan Shifter abilities in order to become, to gain that Shifter's powers and to become Titan. But the question is, who turned into Titan, who did Erwin eat? So they sort of threw that moment in there, a little clue in there. So we kind of get that in there, that sort of builds up to that revelation that, yeah, Erwin's dad was a Titan Shifter, and he gave Erwin powers to eat him and then take the powers for himself. But yeah, just the whole moment between Grisha basically killing the Rice family members. You kind of see this moment between with Frieda where she has these sort of look in her eyes, and there's a color of purple in her eyes. And when Grisha ends up eating her, and he takes the power for himself, his eyes change to purple as well. We haven't seen that with Eren yet, I believe. His eyes have always been green. Except for that moment in season 1 in the anime, I think in the last episode, where he goes into berserker mode, which is something that hasn't happened in the manga, but apparently that's something that Isayama did put in the anime specifically, so maybe it's something that's going to have a callback to much later on in the manga properly, but the anime is probably going to do it more maybe regardless. I don't know, we'll have to wait and see. I'm trying to think of everything else that happened. Kenny's character obviously having his own dream, having his own plans. We don't know what that is. Obviously, we don't find out in episode 6 until I think it was episode 7 when we found out what his goals are. So he obviously had his own agenda. Basically, everyone has their own agendas. Everyone's got their own plans, and it all revolves around Eren. Basically, he's sort of caught in the middle between all of these different people trying to use him for different reasons. But at the same time, you've got Rice getting his story and trying to turn her to his cause, to his side, and using her for his own purposes. So yeah, there's a lot of scheming going on, basically a lot of different plot points and scheming in that. So it is very hectic trying to understand the situation of these plot points and figure out where every character stands. Basically, it's kind of a headache, but that is the Uprising arc. That is the complication of the Uprising arc. It wasn't as simple as it was made out to be. There's a lot of political intrigue going on, basically. So yeah, the highlight of episode 5 was the entire Eren trial, and the highlight of episode 6 was finding out that what happened to Eren's dad, and obviously the whole resolution to the Survey Corps being, as you call it, being freed, being evicted. I don't know the word for it, but basically the people basically realizing the truth that they weren't behind all that shit, and the truth coming out. So, and just having that moment where the characters are just sort of jumping and happy for joy. It is a bit annoying, however, that what's their names, Marlo and Hitch were sent away, because in the manga they were there with these guys. They didn't go back to the unit, they stayed with them. And even at that moment where G just sort of jumps on Marlo's, like, arguing him, and like Hitch is also in between, like, it was a great moment to see all of these different characters reacting like with that happiness. But we could get it here just soon, those characters. So it's sort of what season 2 did with Sasha. She wasn't in the manga in a lot of the scenes because obviously she was planned to be killed off, so I don't know how that even works really, like, because since Isayama kept her alive, wouldn't have made sense to actually continue adding her into the story. So I don't get how he didn't include her in those next chapters, unless he works on specific chapters, and then I don't know how a manga works, so it's very confusing for me. But it's sort of kind of the thing here where they took certain characters out, like where they kept certain characters in, so I don't know, it's a bit weird there. But yeah, I'm trying to remember what else happened. Oh yeah, obviously the ship machine. we didn't get to fully see it, but we saw enough to kind of give people an idea of what it looks like and what was happening. So it's crazy that they kept that in. I mean, at the same time, it was still sort of censored, because again, you didn't see the whole thing, but again, enough visual clues to give you a purpose. But people were still confused, though. People were still confused, especially with the whole holes thing, thinking that was part of the anus, and that was connected to the penis. So basically, the guy's gonna be drinking in his own piss, and there's a I don't know what you call it stuck up his ass, where people are gonna throw food in there. So yeah, it's like that episode from South Park where they eat by putting it up their asshole. So that's kind of the same thing going on here. I'm just going to be curious whether he's going to be shitting stuff out from his mouth, so it'll be, yeah, trying to achieve a bit of humour there, it's not working. But yeah, it kind of gave us an insight into Zachary's character, which even in the previous episode, when he was mocking the officials, where he was telling Eowyn that he, you know, the whole time he wanted to do a coup d'etat, like he was going to do it regardless eventually. but you know, it just happened to align with Erwin having these little moments. So yeah, that's why he helped out in the end. And we find out what an insane, crazy bastard Zack really is. I mean, I remember reading those chapters the first time, and I honestly thought to myself that this dude is probably a Titan in secret. Like, at the time we didn't know who the Beast Titan was, and honestly I just thought this dude is, he's probably a Titan. Like there's just something not right with him. But obviously that wasn't the case. He's not a Titan. He's just a crazy dude with crazy hobbies. Like, I mean to be fair, what he made was very artistic, but but that's not something I would be. The fact is that Pixar even knows about it, so you know, Zachary obviously disgusted with the others, and they all were probably like, "Wow, this dude, our commander, because this dude's the leader of the military," so they were like, "This dude is messed up, like damn." It probably makes you think like, okay, it's probably the reason why he is the leader, because like, he's got the will to do some crazy shit, so it makes you wonder like, what else he's capable of. But yeah, I thought that was a great moment for Zachary's character, just to kind of showcase how demented he is. It's funny and just sick at the same time. So yeah, that was episode 6, I believe, and then we got to episode 7. Yeah, the next episode is episode 8, isn't it? So yeah, we got to episode 7, and this was pretty much the action episode. So we finally got our Survey Corps versus the anti-Survey Corps, basically, and what an action scene it was. This was basically the moment where the characters were finally forced themselves, came to the resolution that they need to do what they need to do. And in this episode, you got to see Gene and Connie kill, and yeah, they did it without hesitation this time. So, and also you got Sasha shooting people with her arrows, shooting fireballs. Levi and Mikasa doing that upcoming thing and diving in and out. That also said, we also did get a little bit of backstory. In the last episode, we got a bit of backstory with Mikasa and Levi, where Levi, you know, asks her what her connection to Kenny is, because we find out that Kenny's also an Ackerman, and Mikasa having to explain that her dad is an Ackerman whose family were sort of, or what do you call it, prejudiced against. And we find out from Kenny's flashback that their family used to be like royal bodyguards of the king, but because they couldn't be controlled by the mind powers that the power the Titan has, or the founding Titan has, the royalty were very afraid of them, because they could control everyone else but just not them, along with the Oriental family, the Asian families. And that explains why how Mikasa's mom and dad came together, because they were members of a clan that were very prejudiced on. And now we have Mikasa, who's this combination of the two different sides that couldn't be controlled by this power. So yeah, and at the same time we get this little moment where Levi even asks her if she's ever had a moment where she had this burst of strength. And if you guys remember back in season 1, when she's about to kill that person, Eren's like, you know, you need to kill to survive. She has this moment where like, we kind of get this little spark moment going in her head, and it looks like a Titan lightning that happens when someone transforms. And we always assumed that was a bit weird, wasn't it? But here we find out that no, there is obviously some sort of connection, because the Ackermans are a special case. They're not just people who couldn't be controlled, they're also people who are very, like even Kenny said, and I think when he was talking to his granddad, They are warriors. They are a family of warriors. But why are they a family of warriors, and how did they become a family of warriors? And they're obviously connected to the Titans in some way, so there is that. We also found out that Kenny has a sister who is in the underground area where Levi used to live, and that she is pregnant with someone's son. So yeah, that's meant to be put two and two together. You're meant to put two and two together and come to the realization that, yeah, Kenny is Levi's uncle. So that was kind of cool to realize, obviously, because you realize that, yeah, Levi is an Ackerman as well, so he's obviously connected to Mikasa in some way. They're probably distant cousins, maybe, but yeah, like, just a lot of info dump, and it was such a crazy thing to find out, because you find out so many different things from so many various sites, from so many various different characters. But then we come back to episode 7 and the action moment, and yeah, like I said, just a brilliant action sequence, great animation being used here. The whole rematch between Levi and Kenny was just great to see. just Levi using tricks to get to Kenny, basically, throwing like the bag of gunpowder or fuel, whatever it was, for Kenny to shoot and light up and cause an explosion that made, and having Levi burst through the flames. Because you don't expect that to happen. You don't expect someone to go through the flames and come at you, and then Kenny using his knife trying to block the attack, and just Levi just managing to pull through and slice through him. The manga was definitely gory. I mean, there was this moment in the manga where Levi cuts a dude in half, like straight up cuts him in half. So they're definitely more tame when it comes to the gore and killing here. But still, it was a great action sequence to see. Hanji gets a moment and then loses it when she gets her ass kicked by the female leader of the group. And it's not using guns; she just uses the hook whip to stab into Hanji, and just uses the momentum to throw into one of the crystal walls, and Hanji falls down injured or dead perhaps. I mean, she's bleeding from the head, so we don't know what's going on there now. That's a casualty of war, as one would say. But yeah, that's probably the first half of the episode, and that ends with going back to Eren, Historia, Rice, and Kenny, and we find out that Kenny wants to eat Eren so he can gain the powers. But he finds out basically that the only people who can gain the powers of the Founding Titan and actually use it are people with the rice blood in them. So that just pisses Kenny off, because like he admits that the whole reason he was even working with Rice, Rod Rice, in the first place was so he could eventually steal the powers, and now he can't. And we also get this little moment where Rice pretty much tells Kenny that he's just his brother's lapdog or something, and we get a little look into this character that we haven't seen yet. We do see this character in this episode actually in the flashback, but we don't know exactly who he is. We know his name is Urien, and he was Rod Rice's brother, or younger, older brother, and he was the previous holder of the Founding Titan power before Frieda, we find out, was Historia's sister, half-sister, who was the original older before Grisha ate her. She ate her uncle, and her uncle was I guess friends with Kenny, because Kenny seems to have a great respect and admiration for this person who's now dead, because he even tells Rice not to insult him. So you know, that kind of goes to show you that Kenny isn't all around psycho. Like this dude has his own code of honor basically. He had a goal. He clearly had respect for someone there as well. There's definitely a lot more to his character than meets the eye. But yeah, whatever goal dream he had is pretty much going out the window. So he decides to semi-free Eren and have him and Historia duke it out basically, and just see who's gonna win. You know, is it gonna be the humanity or is it gonna be these guys? But Historia obviously wises up to her father's manipulations and realizes that this dude, you know, if they had the power to control the Titans for hundreds of years, why was it never used? And Rod himself is just sort of a crazy bastard now at this point, you know, saying that, you know, he tried to convince his dad, him and his brother tried to convince their dad when he had the power, he wouldn't do it. We don't know why they wouldn't do it. There was a look in his eyes that transfers, and that's the power, obviously, and we see that visually represented, and it transfers to Urien, and he, for some reason, couldn't do it either. So, yeah, a lot of secret shit going on there. So yeah, a lot of secret shit going on there, but basically in the end, Historia just, you know, Rod is like Titan, whoever has this power is basically God. Like obviously Urien, my dad, etc, Freya, they knew things that we didn't, because the only people who have this power can see the memories of the past people who've had this power, and they can see the truth of the world, and clearly they know something that they can't say. So for all intents and purposes, we just have to live with that knowledge and just live with the Titans, if that's the case. And yeah, Rod's just like, yeah, whoever has this power is basically God. But that just makes him seem very, very insane. But it also makes him a coward as well, because he doesn't take the power for himself. No, instead he has his daughter eat her uncle, his brother, because he doesn't want to do that, because clearly there's a reason why this has to happen, and it's not being elaborated on. But there's a clear reason why does this power have to be transferred in the first place? Why can't people keep it? Why is this transfer of power? Like, why? So obviously there's more to it than that, and Rod isn't revealing what that is, but you do get the impression that he is scared of taking this power for himself for whatever reason. and he's trying to make Historia do it so he can easily, probably more easily control her, but she's having none of that. She comes to that realization, she's having none of it, and she ends up throwing an old man on his back, I think, which ends up breaking Rod's back. And yeah, she goes to rescue Eren, who at this point is emotionally compromised. I mean, him finding out all this information just basically does him in, and it comes to the point where he's just like, you know, he wants his story to eat him, because if he feels like that his dad has committed a great sin, and it's because of his dad that maybe a lot of this shit happened, and if his dad hadn't taken the powers, you know, a lot of people wouldn't have died. A lot of people from season one, season two wouldn't have died, because they Frida or whoever could have used that power to protect or save those people, control the Titans. But you know, so he's basically telling his story to eat, to just let him die and have the power come back to them, but she's having none of that. Because, and at this point, she even comes to this realization where she's like, she doesn't give a shit about humanity. Like, she's going to be the enemy of humanity, which is a nice foreshadowing, actually, of what's going on in the story right now. So people can put two and two together, and then that's a great foreshadowing from Historia's part, where she's like, I'll be the enemy of people, like, let the Titans win or whatever. And she's trying to rescue her, and she gives him this knock on the head, which is a great little moment there, which is appreciated, because we all want to do that. We all just want to slap Eren on the head and be like, dude, shut the fuck up and just you know, put yourself together, because the amount of times he's been captured now is just ridiculous. But yeah, I can tell you right now, this is probably the last time he's ever going to be captured again, because after this point, he's basically going to become a very capable character, basically, at this point. And it's going to get much worse in terms of how capable he become, because you're probably thinking now, this dude needs to grow up and take things into perspective and into his own hands. Well, he is going to do that eventually, but it's probably not going to be all dandy and good in that when that happens. So, you know, it's like a double-edged sword. You want this character to be determined, way more determined than he is, and yeah, that doesn't turn out the way you expect. It turns out, but it doesn't. So it's a great way, it's a weird thing to see where these characters are now compared to where they are going to be in the next few years. But yeah, it's just crazy to see that. But yeah, the episode as a whole ends with the serum that Rod was about to inject into his story. She throws that off his hand and it collapses. Great facial animation with him just like looking not surprised, just no emotion, and suddenly him come to the realization, holy shit, the serum. Oh, like, it's just such a weird animation thing to do, and only anime can do that for you. So yeah, having Rod just drop down and licking the serum off, and we basically see what happens when it's not injected into the body, because clearly this is meant to be put into the bloodstream and not licked off the floor, but he does it anyway, and he instantly just light flashes and he instantly transforms into what appears to be a colossal Titan. So yeah, and they're in a cave, for Christ's sake. So, and remember, Titans, what's the saying, what was supposed to happen, if you guys remember, like, they tried to trap Annie by going on the ground, right, and this dude's turning into Titan in an underground cavern, and it looks like he's too big for it, because his spine is sort of bending as it's reaching the top. So yeah, clearly this is going to be a big, massive Titan there, and it's crazy, but it's going to be interesting to see how next episode is going to handle all of this, any episode after that. But I can say for sure that this arc as a whole is definitely very rushed. Like, I'm just very curious what the final episode of this arc is going to be. And if I had to make a prediction, I'd say that next episode is going to be the whole thing in the cave of Eren protecting the only one and getting his upgrade, to them escaping, to them reuniting with Erwin's group, and maybe getting that moment of Levi and Historia and them forcing her to become the queen. And episode 9 is going to be the whole fight, and that's just going to be that whole fight there. And then episode 10 is going to be that moment with Levi and Kenny, and we're going to get that flashback and that whole moment. And then episode 11 is just going to be the aftermath of the uprising arc. Like, then we're going to see how things have transformed and changed before all the characters decide to head out for that big mission. And then episode 12 is going to be that flashback with a returning character and Eren finding out more about his dad and that, so before they head to that to where they have to go, to the basement, basically. And then episodes 13 to probably 24 is just going to be the entire arc. So I'm thinking that's what the schedule is going to be like. We'll find out, I think we'll find out next week what the overall schedule is going to be. But yeah, this arc as a whole, like, it's been good, but I'm not gonna say it's been bad. No, like this, the anime is not bad at all. The animation, the performances, the voice acting, especially by the ones who voice act Erwin for that trial scene, and Eren as well for that moment where he's just sort of desperately just saying like he wants to die, and that have all been good, have all been very emotional. The important bits that they had to make really, really good, they made really, really good, and the action has been, you know, the human on human action has been incredible so far. So it's not a bad anime at all. To say that it's bad is disrespectful to how much of a good job which studio has done, to what Isayama has done in terms of helping out with sort of making this arc better in his opinion. But it's just disappointing from a manga reader's perspective that we didn't get some of those moments. And obviously some manga readers are probably gonna be happy they didn't get those moments, because again, the manga, that means the anime gets to go at a faster pace. But I would have liked to see those scenes adapted, especially the Reeve scenes. I would have really liked to have those. But it is what it is, so take it or leave it, right? Anyway, guys, that's my review for Attack on Titan Season 3, episodes, I think 5, 6, and 7. So, yeah, hope you enjoyed it. As always, like and subscribe, whatever. And I shall see you when I shall see you. Take care and bye.